I'm so sorry. He's from Barcelona.
I didn't realise how strong John was until...
Morning, Fawlty.
Morning, Major.
The window, see? Look, the window, see?
I remember one occasion when it did hurt. I'm staring at him lovingly.
Get a clean one.
It's clean now.
And he goes, Emmanuel, you're a waste of space. Dying. And then I thought that was the end of it, but no, then he runs the thing spoon down me and goes, dying into my teeth.
He's dirty now.
I found him physically ever so slightly out of control. When we were doing the scene at the table where he had to clamp his hand around my mouth, it was clamped around my mouth, and then he had to knock me out with a sort of karate chop. And I think in rehearsal I said, can you just pull that back a bit, please? Because he was giving me a terrible whack. And he's a big guy, you know, a big, strong man. Sorry, yes.
Don't worry, a little cheese went the wrong way.
It was great fun to do. Great stuff, yes, and bloody painful.
No, no!
Doof. Oof, one in the cobblers and fill the suitcase.
I suppose I must unfortunately take some credit for the physical side of things in Fawlty Towers. I like schadenfreude, I like cruelty.
Hello, dear. Just going to...
The only problem I had with Prue is I could never get her to hit Basil hard enough. It was terribly important to me that it be done with a ferocity that would make us aware that she could be physically frightening as well as frightening in the normal female sense.
What did you hit me for?
How dare you?
Did John Howard Davies say I hit him very hard or I didn't want to?
He said you didn't want to.
Well, he's a lovely guy. I don't want to hurt him.
Well, we all make mistakes, dear.
I like people being hit because I think it's funny.
It was decreed that I would get a frying pan, clad the bottom with cotton wool and some fabric, spray it down so it looked all burnt like the bottom of a frying pan, stick it on the shelf. And then come the evening, of course, the adrenaline's flowing, John reaches round with his immense arms, grabs the frying pan next to the one I've dealt with and... bangs Andy over the head like there's no tomorrow. And I mean, if he didn't go out, he came jolly close to it.
The layout of the hotel's clever from a television point of view, it seems to me. I mean, one can overanalyze these things, but essentially, you take it further and further away from the book at reception with the bookings in, and it gets more and more confused. Manuel doesn't know where he is most of the time. Basil doesn't know who's in which room a lot of the time, gets very confused. The guests for the anniversary party aren't sure where Sybil is. There's an amazing capacity for mayhem just in the fact that there's this upstairs area with lots of different doors.
And what was good about it is that the viewers got to know this building. There was the lobby there, kitchen was there, the stairs going up to the bedrooms, and particularly these stairs, four steps down, five up.
We had to make these enormous sets to accommodate somebody who's 6'5". The difficulty with that, of course, is they all shook when everybody rushing about and jumping up and down.
And with the speed with which people moved, it did tend to wobble.
And you could knock on the wall and the whole wall, and even the door, you know, go like that. There are moments, actually, if you look carefully, where the wall moves where it really shouldn't move at all.
Don't you dare try and come in here tonight.
In Fawlty Towers, every moment, every detail is made use of, even down to the signs.
Newspapers!
I used to do the crossword, as I still do, and sitting there doing it, John leant across and said, you do anagrams, don't you? I went, yes. He said, work out some anagrams of Fawlty Towers.
One was Farty Towels, Flay Otters.
It was, in fact, the paper boy who were always being slapped or punched for being late, who used to do it on the way out.
I suggested that you have a kid running away from it, having just done it. I thought that was a rather good suggestion.
And most of them, that was, will have been spotted, aren't true anagrams. The only true one is flowery twats.
I'm not absolutely sure that most people understood what it meant.
So I think most of the people working in comedy seem to have depressions. Whether they're any worse, better or worse than people in other jobs, I'm not sure. But I suspect there's something about the depressive temperament that seems to produce comics.
John takes things very seriously. If only John would get in touch with his interior silliness more often, he'd have a happier time.
He's very serious, very caring, very tall. What he's not is funny. He's not funny at all.
I don't know how much my feelings show, but I can feel exceptionally sour when people shout out, "All right! Give us your funny walk then." You know, everyone turns and looks.
Oi, Basil!
When I first met John, he was just charming and lovely and amusing and witty. And obviously, as time went on, I discovered that he was actually quite a complex man. He could be moody, he could be difficult, he could be pompous, he could be intimidating, and sometimes I thought he was a bit of a bully.
Not unlike the leading man in Britain's best sitcom. Writing partner and wife, Connie Booth, spotted the Basil in John.
John's sort of so much Basil, parts of him, and of his father, whom we both knew pretty well, that it's familiar. It was familiar to both of us, you know.
I have a feeling that situations could arise when I would almost go as berserk as Basil. Really?
I think the genius of John and Connie is that they managed to combine John's failings into the character. She obviously knew John better than anybody else. She knew his failings. We used to go out to dinner and he would treat the Italian waiters just like Manuel. He was just really seething when they got something wrong. And I don't think he was setting himself up. The genius is to take that side of your character and I'm going to say exaggerate. It wasn't very exaggerated. But to make fun of yourself is quite a difficult thing.
John and Connie were breaking up as they wrote Fawlty Towers.
It is amazing for two people who are breaking up to actually be working together. It is, I mean, it must be the only time in the world. Everybody else who's breaking up must be fighting and you know, stabbing each other in the back. Here's two people who are breaking up and they're working together.
For us, it was a release.
Yes.
We were able to get out a lot of our frustrations with each other through those characters. And it was kind of like therapy.
They managed to keep it secret for some years, I think. One never really knew when the actual split happened.
John would come in through the doors and say good morning to everybody, and where's Connie? Oh, she's parking the car or something like that, I thought, you know. So 5 minutes later, Connie comes in, and she goes over to John and gives him a kiss, and he says, "Did you have a good sleep last night? Did you have a nice breakfast?" "Oh, yes."
"Brilliant!"
So that's the first I knew that they weren't together anymore. Kept it from me, anyway.
He did have a sort of an inbuilt double take, you know, where he would say, "I just..."
He's very good at the long pauses because there's so much going on. He knows how to stretch a pause beyond the limits of most actors' daring.
Well, who's for trifle?
What about the duck, Fawlty?
Ducks off, sorry.
The incident with the car is wonderful in terms of timing, and it's a single shot, so it's John's timing.
I thought we'd do that little scene in a little suburban street.
You vicious bastard! Come on!
And I made him park the car up on the pavement, rather oddly.
Right! Well, don't say I haven't warned you! I've laid it on the line to you time and time again!
And the timing is absolutely brilliant. He goes out, pause, 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 pause.
And you actually don't know what's going to happen. You think that could be the end of the shot. It's, we're trained, everyone's trained, and we've seen so much of it. We think, OK, shot ends now. It's going to cut away. Comes back in with a tree.
I think that's part of John's genius, that he could hold that pause when he went out of shot.
Fawlty Towers is the sitcom that can't be copied. Other countries thought they could make their own versions. America had the Whispering Pines Hotel, run by John Payne. This was their idea of giving his car a good thrashing on gourmet night. The series suffered a similar fate.
I need more ducks!
I don't have more ducks!
What about these ducks?
Those my ducks!
And German hoteliers Victor and Helga Stein only entertained their guests for one episode, despite the obvious passion with which it was performed.
Chef?
Kann ich jetzt endlich einen Gin Tonic und einen Whisky Sauer bekommen?
Sauer.
But the original thrived wherever it went.
In Spain, when it was dubbed into Spanish, Manuel becomes Manolo or somebody, and he's Italian. He can't be Spanish in Spain, he's Italian. He's an Italian idiot.
Manolo, tu sabes nada.
I actually come from Germany. My first language is German. My name is not Andrew Sachs, but it's Andreas Siegfried Sachs. And a German company wanted to buy the first series, and they asked me, since they knew I came from Germany, would I do my part, go over to Munich, do my part in German with a Spanish accent.
Mrs. Fawlty, Mr. Fawlty.
Was ist?
Stürzen, fallen, klatsch von Leiter.
Von Leiter?
We did that, but they only bought the five. Because the one episode they didn't buy is, guess what, the German episode. They couldn't quite take it in the 70s.
Little Andreas Siegfried Sachs wearing his lederhosen in the Black Forest. How could he know that one day he would collaborate in the most celebrated scene of Jerry bashing in sitcom history?
Don't mention the war.
The Germans, don't mention the war.
I see.
You just know Basil. You hear the word Germans. It's almost like a green flag going.
Right, right, here's the plan. I'll stand there and ask them if they want something to drink before the war. Before their lunch.
So that's two egg mayonnaise, a prawn Goebbels, a Hermann Göring, and four colded salads.
People are actually crying, breaking down. That's very real, that moment, you know, because that generation, the 70s generation, the Helmut Schmidt generation of Germans, you know, fantastically sensitive to the Third Reich.
And her husband's in a bomber over Berlin. Oh, sorry. Sorry. Yeah. She'll love this. She'll love it.
Of course, it only makes Basil's extreme impersonations of Hitler, etc., and his prawn Goebbels all the funnier and all the more horrific.
Will you stop talking about the war?
Me? You started it?
We did not start it.
Yes, you did. You invaded Poland. would you care for rats?
It was so wise to just do 12. Because if you'd done another series and it hadn't been quite so good, you devalue the currency of the first two, and they got 12 perfect television, British television farces.
There was talk of a film, there was talk of plays, there were talk of endless talks of, let's do some more. And I think John and Connie were absolutely right to say, that's enough, that's it, we've done it.
Fawlty Towers could have gone for years. I mean, just don't let anybody say to me again, isn't it wonderful, they only had a few.
Now, if there were 150 and they were all that good, that'd be great, but I think John would have exploded.
I asked John once, would you ever write any more? And he said, yeah, I think I would. Yeah, I would. And I said, would you write it without Connie? He said, no.
Thank you, Polly, for the...
She'd got married again, I think, and so had he.
Well done, Manuel.
Okay.
Oh, olay.
You know, I have take afternoon off from hotel to make this record so I can become very famous big-time pop star. It's already big hit in Barcelona with my brothers and sisters. They clap very much when I sing. Uno, dos, tres, cuatro, what's the matter, you? Hey! Got no respect.
Jonathan Ross pops up in a moment with the other contenders, and next week it's the third of your top 10 favourites, The Good Life. It's a nice place, I'll shut up your face. Louder!